you. Good morning, everyone. Good to see Paul, John, Jafina, Sidikeno, and Silitoli. Can I ask Paul to lead us in prayer, please?
Let's pray. Father Almighty God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for yet another day in our life. We thank you for this moment that we are going to hear your word, because your word is good and it is live all the time. Father, as we are going to partake of it, let it bear fruits in our life. Let it give us wisdom. Let it give us knowledge. Let it strengthen us. We pray that let the internet also be stable throughout. We pray and commit this into your hand. We pray all this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Paul.
You're welcome.
So last week, last Wednesday, before we finished class, you know, we began looking at chapter 6, Kingdom Culture. And before that, we looked at kingdom lifestyle, kingdom living. We saw a few characteristics in kingdom lifestyle, kingdom living, that is holiness and reverence, righteousness, peace, and joy, power, authority, and dominion, endurance and suffering, forgiveness, no partiality, being ready for the king, and being celibate for the kingdom's sake. Okay, so today we're going to look at continue looking at chapter 6, where we're talking about kingdom culture. And last class I mentioned in chapter 5 that in John chapter 18 verse 36, Jesus said that my kingdom is not of this world. So when we are born again, we are born again into the kingdom of God. We are born again into the kingdom of heaven. We belong to the culture, the lifestyle, the thought process, and the values of the kingdom of God. Okay, and then we looked at a few important thing about being part of the kingdom culture is our identity, who we are. We are kings and priests, and we read Revelation chapter 1. Verses 5 and 6, where he says that you know, as believers, we've been washed from our sins by the blood of Jesus, and he has made us kings and priests to our God. And then we looked at both the present and application of us being priests and kings to our God, and also we looked at the future tense application of us being priests and kings. So the present tense application is that, you know, presently we are kings and priests in God's kingdom. We represent God's rule and reign here on earth. And, you know, we intercede on behalf of the people. And we also are here to see his kingdom come in our earthly realm. Okay, so as a priest, we said that, you know, we are to worship God, we are to glorify God, and also take up matters of earth to heaven, to seek God's heart, to bring in heavenly intervention in the affairs of the life of mankind. And then we also saw there is a future tense to this, where you know, each one of us will, based on how faithful we have been here on the days of our life, that, you know, we will be appointed as kings and priests when we will reign on earth, literally in his kingdom, which we read in the Revelation chapter 5, verses 9 to 10. So as a nation, you know, as a people group that's belonging to the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, we are a separate nation, a race, a tribe of people who have the same habit, customs, and culture. So as kings and priests, we are people of, you know, belonging to the kingdom culture. We share common kingdom culture amongst ourselves. And we have, you know, we share attitudes, values, goals, and practices that, you know, characterize us as people belonging to the kingdom of God. Okay. So what is the importance of actually, you know, belonging to a kingdom culture is, you know, when we all live kingdom lifestyle, when we think kingdom patterns, kingdom from the kingdom perspective, what does it really do? How does it really help? You know, or when we adhere to kingdom culture, you know, share the same attitudes, the values, the goals, the beliefs, the behavior patterns, what does it do? It actually builds a community of believers, you know, because we are, say, we are all following the kingdom thinking, the kingdom living, and hence we create a kingdom culture in our environment. And what does this, how does this help? You know, this really helps in when people from, you know, from the world or, you know, from darkness, they come in and they engage with us, you know, they would experience the power of God. They will experience the truth of God. They will experience the lifestyle of God, the culture of God, and you know that will change them. So the kingdom culture will overpower the evils of any culture around it. So you know when people come from darkness into the kingdom of God, you know. You know, they would their culture will be changed. You know, they will be overpowered by the power of God. The power of evil in them will be overpowered, and you know, and they will be set free, and they will be part of God's kingdom culture, or part of the kingdom of God, or the kingdom of heaven. So that is what we looked at before we ended class last week. We just began to look at the different facets of the kingdom culture, and we looked at culture of honor. So we look at the different facets of kingdom culture. Kingdom culture is a culture of honor, okay? And we looked at when do we show honor to someone. And that's where we stopped, okay? We give honor to with what we say, what we do, when we speak highly of people, when we refuse to defame people, when we stand up in the presence of a person and, you know, we applaud them, we appreciate them, encourage them, we give financially into their lives, or we serve in any way, we show honor to that person, okay? So whom do we honor? Okay, as part of people who are part of the kingdom culture, who do we honor? We honor our king, that is our Lord and God, who is the head of the kingdom. And we also bestow honor on those whom God has appointed to serve in specific functions in the kingdom. Okay, so there are people that God has appointed, prophets, priests, apostles, teachers, who God has specifically given them the functions in the kingdom of God, who we need to honor as well. If you look at 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 17, Paul is writing to Timothy and he's saying, those who lead God's people well and those who labor in word and doctrine are to be given double honor. Okay. So here it says that those who are in the fivefold ministry office functions, those who actually labor for the word and the doctrine are to be given double honor. So when we honor someone, you know, you what does it do? It actually blesses you in return. You know, you receive through their life. So it's not like you're just giving them honor for, you know, just because you have to, but you know, when you do it with a sincere heart, you actually receive through their life. So Matthew chapter 10, verses 41 and 42. Can somebody read that, please? Matthew 10, 41 and 42. Matthew 10, 41 and 42.
Matthew 10, 41, 42. He who receives a prophet in the name of a prophet shall receive a prophet's reward, and he who receives a righteous man in the name of a righteous man shall receive a righteous man's reward. And whoever gives one of these little ones only a cup of cold water in the name of a disciple, assuredly I say to you, he shall by no means lose his reward.
Thank you, Zelatoli. So here we see that, whoever welcomes a prophet as a prophet will receive a prophet's reward, okay? Whoever welcomes a righteous person as a righteous person will receive a righteous person's reward. So when you receive or honor a prophet, a righteous man, or a disciple, who are part of the kingdom of God, then you receive a reward that represents who they are. Okay, I'd just like to give you a couple of examples from the Bible. Anyone can give me a couple of examples from the Bible where you read how, you know, people have basically honored a prophet or a righteous man and they received a reward. Any narratives from the Bible you have read, do you remember, comes to your mind? Anyone?
I think, I don't know the name, Elijah, I guess someone, the widow used to go give him a floor of bread and then her son will be healed.
You're right, Jeffina. It's Elijah when he was, after he told King Ahab that, there won't be rain in the land because of the wickedness. And then God tells him to go and stay near the brook of Cherith. And then, he provides ravens to feed him. And then the water dries up there. Then God tells him to go to Zarephath, where he's going to meet a widow. And, when he goes there, he sees a widow with the son, picking up sticks. So he knows that this is a lady and he tells her to go bring water. And then he tells her to, give him a piece of bread. And then she says, I have very little with this, it's the last meal that my son and me will eat. And but he says, do what I say. Okay, and then when she gets it done, he says, the oil will never run out, and the flour will in the jar will never run out. And then we see likewise, for the time that he spent, Elijah spent with staying with that widow in Zarephath, though the others around there was severe famine because there was no rain, but because of this woman's obedience, she had, every time she put her hand to take out flour, there was flour. Every time she poured the jar of oil, there was oil. And so that is receiving a prophet's reward. Anyone else? Jonathan, yeah. David, okay. Okay, Isaac, sorry.
Yes, there is the story of the Shunammite woman. Mm-hmm. Who provided accommodation for the prophet, and she was richly blessed thereafter.
Yes, good example. Thank you, Isaac. So the Shunammite woman, who did not have, she and her husband, whenever Elisha is to come to their town to invite them and, give a meal to him. And they realize that the prophet keeps coming to their town, so why not build a room upstairs? So they build a room upstairs, put a table, a chair, a cot, and a bed so that he can come and stay there. And Elijah wanted to repay this Shunammite woman for what she's done. And so, she tells, he tells her, his servant Gehazi asks him, and Gehazi says, she doesn't have a son or a child. So calls her and says, by this time next year, you will have a son. Okay. And so she was like, I'm already old. Don't give me that joy now. But, she does have a son. And what happens? Her son, when grows up, I think a little older, he dies one day. And then we see that, the Shunammite lady goes, finds where Elisha is. And when Gehazi, so Elisha sees her from a distance, sends Gehazi. And she says, no, all is well. And she just goes and tells Elisha to come. And then Elisha goes and resurrects her son back to life. So here we see these instances in the Bible where, you know, you receive, when you honor a prophet, a righteous man, or a disciple for who they are in the kingdom, then you receive a reward that represents who they are. Okay. And Pastor in his book, which we are following, actually we are studying, he talks about Pastor Bill Johnson, pastor of Bethel Church, Redding, California, and he says, he shares what Pastor Bill Johnson has said. He said, Elisha was trained by Elijah, and we all know that, you know, he asked for a double portion of the anointing from Elijah, and Elisha received a double portion of the anointing and the power, and he did twice as many miracles as than what Elijah had done. Yet, when we read that John the Baptist, who was Jesus' forerunner, we read that he came in the spirit and the power of Elijah, not Elisha. Okay? So even though Elisha had a double portion of the anointing and power, he did many more miracles compared to Elijah. But we see that when John the Baptist came, he came in the spirit and the power of Elijah and not Elisha. And then Pastor Bill Johnson explains why was that. And he says that, you know, God honors the fathers of a movement. So whoever starts a movement, you know, God honors them. He places the honor on the one who paid the price, sowed the seeds to pioneer a fresh move of God in a place. Okay. So we see that, you know, Elijah and Elisha were one of the great prophets, and we see Elijah starting this whole movement of the prophetic ministry so powerfully. And then it was continued by Elisha. So he was the one who pioneered the whole thing. And so, you know, Pastor Bill Johnson says that God honors the fathers of a movement. He places honor on the one who paid the price and sowed the seeds to pioneer a fresh move of God in a place. Okay. So we'll move on to the second facet of a kingdom culture. It's a culture of selfless giving. Okay. So, you know, a kingdom culture described by selfless giving. It's not cumbersome, and there is joy in the process of giving. It could be giving of anything, but time, efforts, comfort, encouragement, support, finances, anything else. And people are sacrificed very willingly, very gladly. It's a spontaneous form of giving. It's not because of compulsion, and it's, you know, because it is spontaneous, it comes from the heart. So selfless giving is seen in the kingdom of God, kingdom men and women belonging to the kingdom of God. And when do we see selfless giving? Is those who serve behind the scenes, unnoticed, and often go unappreciated. You know, in our church, we have many people on a Sunday morning working behind the scenes. You know, they come there as early as 6:30 in the morning. They do all the setup, carrying all the equipment, all the stuff. And, you know, we don't see them on stage. They go unnoticed. They often are, but they are appreciated, you know. But, you know, sometimes most of them are unappreciated, those in our churches who just serve tea, coffee, or, lay, you know, keep the chairs or clean or, you know, whatever they do. So these people are selflessly giving of their time, efforts, and also people who forsake their earthly opportunities and success to invest their time, their energies for serving people and the furtherance of God's kingdom. So I gave you this example, you know, people who are highly educated in good posts, they receive a call of God, and you know, they're willing to let go of everything, give up everything, just to pursue the call of God to go as missionaries or evangelists, or you know, be pastors or whatever. Okay, even give up their degrees. Some of them doctors and engineers, highly educated, you know. And those who expect nothing back from those who have received from us, knowing that God will reward us in due time. So there are people who keep serving, who keep ministering, you know, pastors, missionaries, missionaries in, you know, isolated places. Nobody even knows about them. They're working so hard. And the tribals or the people group or, you know, the people that they're working among don't even have the, you know, the capacity enough to, you know, afford or give them anything in return, but they know that their reward is in heaven. So what do we learn from this? That, you know, kingdom culture is a culture where we do things, we give of our time, efforts, encouragement, you know, financial support and other things, our talents, share our wisdom, our resources, our revelation with people, you know, and do it not because we want to get something in return, not so that we can get a position, not so that we can have fame, not so that we can, you know, people can put us on a pedestal, but, you know, just do it because we want to give into people's life. That should be our motive. That should be our initiative, that when we minister in whatever field, in whatever area, that we're not doing it to get some benefits, to get some reward, but it's just serving Christ and serving his people who are, you know, heirs of God's kingdom. Okay, so this kind of giving is motivated by the words of the king when he says in Matthew 25 verse 40. Can somebody read that? Matthew 25 verse 40. It's there in your PDF in your book.
Matthew chapter 25 verse 40. The king will reply, I tell you the truth, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me.
Thank you. So, you know, this kind of giving is motivated by the love of God and love for people. It's nothing else. It's just pure love. That we are motivated to serve, to give, to minister in spite of the circumstances, in spite of the situation. Okay. Another facet of kingdom culture is a culture of daring faith. It's, you know, people belonging to the kingdom of God are characterized by people of daring faith who are able to stand in the midst of hardship, you know, with joy in their hearts, with strength, willing to face things because they know who is with them. You know, they trust in a God who is able to see them through, who is able to take them through. And they also have a kind of faith that, you know, they're willing to take risks. Okay, like Peter stepping out the boat and walking on the water, you know, willing to take risks every day of their lives, you know, based on their faith in God, based on what God is telling them to do. Most of the time, you know, when we take the steps of faith, it's basically, it's we know that it's God asking us to do it. There's a stirring in our heart. There's a push in our heart. You know, we hear clearly from God. And we also see that these people don't mind putting their reputation on the line to see God's kingdom come and this will be done. But, you know, they do all of this because what is the motivation behind all this is to see God glorified, you know, in any and every way. So this is a kind of faith that if we belong to the kingdom culture, if we say we belong to the kingdom of God, we say we belong to the kingdom of heaven, then we need to have this daring faith. And like we just saw, we need to have, you know, be selfless in giving to other people, and also a culture of honor where we're honoring, esteeming people above ourselves. Okay. So when we have this kind of faith, it actually sees the advancement of the kingdom of God in any area, you know, in the marketplace, in the business world, in the arts and entertainment, education field, wherever, you know, when you have this daring faith, it just sees the advancement of God's kingdom. And even if we want, you know, to see signs, miracles, wonders, deliverance, healings happening, then we need to have this kind of faith, daring faith. So if you belong to the kingdom of God, our culture is a culture of daring faith. It's also a culture of joy. An example we can look at is when Philip, you know, when the church in Jerusalem was persecuted, and all the disciples, they spread out, and wherever they went, you know, they did not go and hide, but, you know, they went and preached the gospel. So Philip went to Samaria, and he preached the gospel there. And he preached concerning the kingdom of God, and, you know, there was great joy in that city. The Bible says in Acts, you know, there was great joy in the city. Unclean spirits left, the lame were made whole, and the people rejoiced. Okay, I think it's in Acts chapter 5, I think, if I'm not wrong. Let me just look at it. Okay, I think it's not able to find it in Acts chapter 5. Okay, I'll let you know where it is.
Seven,
no? Perfect. Okay, in Acts chapter 7.
20. No,
it's not in Acts chapter 7 as well.
8:26.
Yeah, I think it's 8. No, this is Philip here in Samaria, chapter eight, verse 5. Thank you for helping me in that. Philip went to preach in Samaria. And we see that, you know, verse 8 says, chapter 8, verse 8 says, and there was great joy in that city. Why? Because, you know, unclean spirits left, the lame were made whole, people rejoiced. We read this in verse 7, unclean spirits crying with loud voice came out of many who were possessed, and many who were paralyzed and lame were healed. So, you know, there was great joy in that city. And so we see that, you know, this joy that we have because we belong to the kingdom of God is something that no one can steal, can take away from us. You know, whether it's, you know, difficulties, hardships, slander, persecution that we go through, insults, offenses that we face, personal loss that we go through, losing loved ones, relationships, losing jobs, whatever, nothing can steal this joy. Okay, the joy of the Lord is expressed in and through us, not only through laughter, but also through this calm assurance and the peace that we have in the midst of difficult situations. I don't know if you've gone through difficult situations in your life, you know, and you just experience that amazing peace of God that just comes over you. I mean, it's just such a wonderful experience. You know, you're just going through this around you is so disturbing. What is happening in your life is so disturbing. What you just heard from the doctor is so disturbing. But there's this amazing sense of peace and joy that comes. And you're so shocked. I mean, this is what the doctor just told me. And, you know, that amazing sense of peace and joy, I just I think it's a year back, I think, a year or more than a year, you know, since I'd gone to the doctor and I had to do a scan, and things were not too good. And the doctor was pretty shocked with the scan, and he told me, you don't know this in your body. And I said, no. He says, how can you not know? And he was quite shocked, and he was, you know, quite taken aback. But then I just, when I stepped out of the room, I just sensed this amazing peace, and I was just smiling and laughing, and I just had this joy of the Lord, and I was like, I was just too shocked, you know, and I was just saying, God, what do I do now? And God is telling me right there, you know, just heard this word just come boom into my heart, you know, I am your portion. And that was so amazing. And that's when, you know, God was reminding me about, you know, the storm, the disciples, they were in the storm, and Jesus said, you know, peace, be still, be still. And everything was calm. And there was amazement in the hearts and in the faces of the disciples. And God is saying, that is the peace that you are experiencing now. And it was such an amazing experience. So even when, you know, situations around us can be quite overwhelming, can be very difficult, you know, we can experience the joy of the Lord. We can experience His peace, which is really so wonderful, which is really so uplifting. And we know that it's just God. Okay. So, you know, we can experience God's peace in the midst of any situation. So it's the ability to, you know, experience the peace of God when situations are weighing down on us. It's a joy that enables people and the community to also stick together, even when things are pulling us apart. Okay, whether it's family, whether it's church, whether it is spouse, a relationship with spouse, you know, there are conflicts that happen, Bible study groups, whatever group we are engaged in, conflicts that happen. But, you know, even when things try to pull us apart, you know, we learn to stick together. And it's the joy that brings about unity and fellowship in the spirit. So a kingdom culture is an environment of such joy, inexpressible and full of glory, that we read in 1 Peter 1:8. Okay, it's a kingdom culture where we experience the inexpressible joy. We just can't express that, and it's full of glory. Okay, that's when God manifests His glory. Manifests His glory means who He is and what He does. He comes through for us. Okay, a culture of heaven invading earth. It's we know that in the Lord's Prayer, we pray, Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And it's God's will, plan, even before the foundations of the world, that, you know, the kingdom culture be manifested here on earth. So we are to pray that His kingdom would come and His will be released on earth as it is in heaven, you know. In our lives, in our family, in our extended families, in our neighborhood, in our city, in our nation, the nations of the world. Okay, what is the kingdom culture? It is God's will, or what is God's will? Now, when we pray, let your kingdom come, let your will be done, what is God's will? It is for the lost to be saved, the sick to be healed, the demons to be cast out, the captives to be set free, the poor to hear the good news, the homeless to have shelter, the hungry to be fed, the naked to be clothed, the widows and orphans to be cared for, those who are mistreated, abused, to receive relief and hope. Everything that actually basically represents the invading of heaven on earth. So a kingdom culture will be an environment where all of these things happen all the time. And, you know, it just does not happen automatically. You know, God has given us, He has made us heirs along with Him, co-heirs along with Christ. He has given us the keys of the kingdom, which He's taken back from Satan. So we are the rulers. We have to subdue, we have to take dominion. We need to bring God's kingdom, his culture, his living, his lifestyle, the thought process here on earth. And it has to begin with me. It has to begin with each one of us. And that will invade, or that will just move through. When we all live with the same culture, ideologies, mindset, values, goals, beliefs, behaviors, then we create a kingdom culture. When others see it, when they come in, when they see it, you know, they will be overpowered by the power of God, and they will become part of the kingdom of God. Okay, so that is about kingdom culture. Anyone has any questions? Or you have anything that you did not understand, you want more clarity? Anyone? Is it clear? Okay. Okay, so we'll move on to another very exciting, thank you, Silatoli and Roslyn. Move on to another interesting part of the kingdom of God, which is kingdom parables. Okay, we all like stories. And so we're going to look at kingdom parables. You know, the kingdom, in the kingdom of God, is such an important topic in the Bible. We've already seen that, you know, from the very beginning, as we saw in Genesis, we saw how God, even before the foundations of the world, he had planned for a kingdom to be established. And, you know, this is the same theme that we see even in the very last chapter in Revelation, you know, where, you know, God wants to establish a kingdom where people will inherit the kingdom. And so in the closing chapter of the Bible, we see, you know, he's a king of all kings, the Lord of all lords, and the extent of his kingdom, there is no limit and no end. So the kingdom of God, the theme kingdom of God, you know, is runs through from the beginning, Genesis, right up till Revelation. Now, when Jesus came to earth, you know, and he taught about the kingdom, he spoke to people in parables, okay? And he spoke many parables as a means to communicate hidden truths concerning his kingdom. So he spoke in parables to communicate mysteries, to communicate hidden truths concerning his kingdom. Okay, so we'll examine some of the parables, and we'll understand the truths or the hidden mysteries that God, that Jesus wanted to communicate to each one of us. Okay, so parables basically reveal to us mysteries, or reveals to us hidden truths concerning the kingdom of God. Now, before we look at some of the parables, let's turn to John chapter 3, verses 19 to 13. Okay, can somebody read that, please? John chapter 3, verses 19 to 13.
John chapter 3, verses 19 to 13.
Sorry, it's 9 to 13, but 9 to 13.
Nicodemus answered and said to him, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered and said to him, "Are you the teacher of Israel and do not know these things? Most assuredly, I say to you, we speak what we know and testify what we have seen, and you do not receive our witness. If I have told you earthly things and you do not believe, how will you believe if I tell you heavenly things? No one has ascended to heaven but he who came down from heaven, that is the Son of Man who is in heaven."
Thank you, Roslyn. So here in John chapter 3, verses 9 to 13, we see Jesus in a conversation with a very learned person, Nicodemus, who's a scholar, a learned man, and Jesus is explaining to him the need to be born again. Okay, so he's using something from our world or our natural world to tell Nicodemus about the spirit realm, spirit world, about the need to be born from above. And Nicodemus is not able to understand this, And we read in verses 9 to 12, Jesus tells Nicodemus, you cannot understand what I'm talking to you about earthly things. And you can't just understand me when I'm talking to you about earthly things. Then what would you do if I told you about heavenly things? How will you understand it? Okay, so here Jesus is facing a challenge. He's trying to explain this to Nicodemus, who's a scholar, learned person. He's trying to explain him the things of the spiritual realm, the spiritual kingdom, the spirit, and he's using something from our world, from our natural world, to communicate from him. But sadly, Nicodemus is not able to understand it. And Jesus tells him, I'm talking to you about earthly things and you cannot understand me. What would you do if I told you about heavenly things? How will you understand it? So Jesus says, he's the only one who could tell him of the heavenly things because he's come down from heaven. Jesus says, in fact, I am from heaven, and though he's on earth, Jesus says, I am in heaven, and though he's on earth, he's connected to heaven in his spirit. And he says, I can tell you the heavenly things, the things of the unseen kingdom. Okay, so Jesus says, I am the only one who can reveal to you, the things of the unseen kingdom, the mysteries of the unseen kingdom, because I am in heaven, which means Jesus is saying, yes, he's on earth, but, he's connected to heaven in his spirit, man. And so he says, I can tell you of heavenly things, things of the unseen kingdom. So Jesus had basically had a challenge here. It was about, how to reveal to Nicodemus, also how to reveal to people who are listening to him, who come every day and listen to his teachings, also to reveal to us unseen things, the things of the world he comes from, okay, because we're not able to understand it. So sometimes when he spoke of things of our world, we were able to understand it, but when he spoke things of his world, we could not understand. So Jesus had to bridge this gap, and that's where this whole concept of parables come in, and this is what Jesus began to do. He used stories of our world, our natural world, our understanding, to unveil the mysteries of his world. Okay, so that's what parables simply is. It's because Jesus was trying to communicate things, trying to reveal things of the unseen world that he comes from. When he spoke of the things of our world, also sometimes we were not able to understand. So Jesus had to bridge this gap, and that's where he brings about this whole concept of parables, where he uses stories of our world to unveil the mysteries of his world, and that is what parables are. Okay, so parables are basically stories from our world that help us see into or help us get an understanding of things concerning the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven. So many times when Jesus was speaking in parables, he would say, this is what the kingdom of God is like, or this is what the kingdom of heaven is like. And then he would tell something from our world. He would always start the parable by saying, this is what the kingdom of God is like, and then he would go on to tell us something from our world with the intent that we would get an understanding of his world or understanding of the heavenly kingdom that he comes from. Okay, let's look at Matthew chapter 13 verses 10 to 17. Can somebody read that, please? Matthew chapter 10 verses 13 verses 10 to 17. Matthew 13:10-17.
Matthew chapter 13, verse 10-17. The disciples came to him and asked, why do you speak to the people in parables? He replied, the knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom of heaven has been given to you, but not to them. Whoever has will be given more, and he will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what he has will be taken from him. This is why I speak to them in parables. Though seeing, they do not see. Though hearing, they do not hear or understand. Until which verse first?
17. Can you read 17, please?
In them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah. You will be ever hearing, but never understanding. You will be ever seeing, but never perceiving. For this people's heart has become callous. They hardly hear with their ears, and they have closed their eyes. Otherwise, they might see with their eyes, hear with their ears, understand with their hearts, and turn, and I would heal them. But blessed are your eyes because they see, and your ears because they hear. For I tell you the truth, many prophets and righteous men long to see what you see but did not see it, and to hear what you hear but did not hear it.
Thank you, Jeffina. So here we see the disciples coming and asking Jesus in verse 10 of chapter 13, why do you speak to them in parables? Why do you speak to the people in parables? And Jesus replies, says, as for you, that means he's telling his disciples, you have been given the opportunity to understand the mysteries of the kingdom. So it means that the disciples, God has given all those who believe in Jesus, we are also his disciples, we also believe in Jesus. God has given us the grace for us to know the mysteries of the kingdom. Okay, I'm sure you must be excited about this. Okay, it just excites me to know that, you know, God has given us the grace to know the mysteries of the kingdom. And that's why, you know, when he asked his disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? And they replied, some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, and still others, you know, Jeremiah or any one of the prophets. But Jesus asked them, but who do you say I am? Okay, Jesus tells them, but what about you? You know, and he asked them, who do you say I am? And, you know, Simon Peter says, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And Jesus tells him that flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. Okay, so this is a good example where we can see that, you know, people are trying to understand who Jesus is. They are saying he's John the Baptist, Elijah, Jeremiah, one of the prophets. But it's to the disciples that, you know, God reveals who Jesus exactly is. So it was given to the disciples to know the hidden truths of the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. Okay, so the general public would just come and listen to Jesus. And Jesus said they have eyes, but they cannot see. They have ears, but they cannot hear. They cannot understand the mysteries of the kingdom with their heart. Okay, they can't discern. They can't perceive. So in order to bridge this gap and in order to communicate the mysteries of the kingdom, Jesus says, here's what I'm doing. I'm speaking to them in parables. I'm taking stories from their world to help them see things in my world. But in the process of giving the explanation to the disciples, you know, Jesus also says something. He says, this is how it works in the kingdom of God. If you have and are going after for more, then you will have abundance. If you have little and are not doing anything with it, you will lose even the little that you have. Now, here's something very, very important about the kingdom of God, you know. If we receive revelations, this is in the context of understanding the mysteries of the kingdom of God. You want more, you're going after more, you're saying, God, please, you're studying God's word, you're hungry for God's word, you're meditating on God's word, you want God to reveal things to you, you know, you will be given abundance of revelation. So you think you might be wondering how, you know, some people can write so many books like Pastor Ashish and such wonderful revelations. Is because from a very young age, he has been, you know, hungry for God's word, pursuing a revelation. So here the word of God says, you know, anyone who receives these revelations, these mysteries, the kingdom of God, and you want more and you're going after more, but you will be given in abundance. It says, but if you're not doing anything with the little revelation that you've got, then you're going to, you know, you're in a position of risk where you're not only getting, you will not only get more, but, you know, you will also lose out the little that you have. Okay. We'll stop here because it's our break time, and we'll come back after the break and we'll continue. Okay.